Yeah, my dudes, check out these funky glasses. Hello. Can you see my eyes? In the reflection? I don't know if you can. Anyway, basically these glasses are designed for like lying down when you're watching movies, so that rather than having to look just forward at your phone, like hold your head up, you can look up and then you can see your phone. So it's like, it's good, but I never watch movies lying in bed. In fact, I really never watch movies, so I don't know why I have these. Like, they don't feel like my own hands. They feel like someone else's hands. Bam. Oh my goodness. Today, we are gonna be talking about 2020. Gonna be talking about New Year's resolutions. Gonna be talking about self-improvement and all of that jazz. I've seen a trend on Instagram recently, and basically people are saying, you know, this is my word of the year and here's why. Now, not to jump on the white girl bandwagon, but to be fair, it is quite motivating. And I'm really into New Year's resolutions, if you can't tell. As much as I don't like to be cornered into something, which I have done to myself. You do it to yourself, you do. You and no one else. Point is, my word for 2020 is intentionality. And that has many, many, many different facets. So the first facet of intentionality is to stop being a people pleaser all the time, Melon. I'm the biggest people pleaser, and it's really only come to my conscious attention in the last 12 months. I'm not an alpha female, I'm not like my way or the highway. I will go with the flow, but my weakness in that is just doing what other people want me to do because it'll make them happy. And I know you're all gonna resonate with this because it's not like I'm not special in this, but I am so over it. There were years that I sort of knew this but didn't really care because as a young person, a lot of people think it's important to say yes to all the opportunities so that you can, you know, move up in the workplace, you can meet new people, so that you can basically get ahead in life, to like put it bluntly. You're trying to get ahead in life, and so you people please and you say yes to everything. And I've been doing that for a very long time, but this year it sort of all caught up to me, and I had a moment, well, many moments, where I just thought, you know, why am I doing this? It's not helping me in any way, shape, or form. It's not actually allowing me to do what I want to be doing. It's just helping other people do what they want to do. I want to stop doing that, and I can let my yes be yes and let my no be no. Sort of setting up boundaries, saying no a lot more, being intentional about the activities that I pursue, the time that I spend not scrolling through Instagram as much, and also being intentional about the friendships that I maintain and I invest in and I keep, because sometimes it's just overwhelming and you end up spending more time with the people you don't want to be spending with than the people you do want to be spending with. Does anybody vibe me or is it just me? I don't know. Anyway, the second aspect of intentionality is being more intentional about my creativity, hence why you will see a new backdrop behind me, and I've taken everything out of my cupboards and put it on my desk so that everything is always visible. This way I'm not having to like go through cupboards and find my paints, like they're right there, so I'm a lot more inclined to paint stuff. And Thomas Frank talks about this. I don't know if you've heard of him, he's a really good YouTuber, and he talks about the fact that when you're trying to improve, or you're trying to do something as a habit, you should set in place the path of least resistance. So basically, you know, if you want to go running every morning at 5 a.m, rather than having to dig through your cupboard and find your exercise clothes and a whole hullabaloo, you just put your exercise clothes out the night before and you're ready. So you're stopping all the excuses and it's a really easy process. And I follow a lot of artists and designers and illustrators and influencers and creative people on Instagram. And the one thing they have in common, every artist has a unique style. Even Picasso, right? He was well known for having many different art periods and styles, but he was consistent for a period of time and then he moved on to something else. And so that's what, sort of what I want to do. At the moment, it's very sort of here and there and piecemeal approach to art making. And I guess I haven't really taken the time to really get to know what I truly like doing. If you go to my Instagram page, you'll probably notice it's quite colorful. At the moment, I'm doing a bit of a color theme, which has been so restrictive, oh my goodness. So 2020 is gonna be changing all that. So yeah, color is one thing, and I also like portraiture, but I'm really undecided, like guys, what should I do? I would love to hear your ideas and maybe how you've established your own creative practice. Was there some sort of a shortcut or a trick that you used to discover your personal style? Let me know. Without further ado, I will take you on a mini tour of my new art space and you can have a look at all my supplies and stuff. Thank you.
Okay, so this is essentially my art studio area. It's not huge, but there is a lot of bench space, which makes it good because I can be doing digital art here and be doing other kind of art there and also have a painting going on at the same time. So it's very, very practical, lots of multitasking. But coming from this direction, so we have my easel here, and it's a fantastic easel. I got it for Christmas from my boyfriend, and it's adjustable, so you can... Oh, my goodness. Oh, you can adjust the height. Okay, that did not go as planned. I can't do it with one hand, but you can adjust the height, and it's also on wheels, so it's movable, and I can sort of, you know, adjust it and stuff. But having an easel is fantastic because I could never do art on my table because it's very narrow, like they're not particularly deep benches. But now that I have an easel, I can do much smaller projects on the bench. And coming across here, so it was Boxing Day and I just got the easel for Christmas, so I was really keen to like set up my art space, and I had only one bench. I didn't have this one. My sister actually announced on Boxing Day that she was going to throw it out, and I was super excited. I was like, yes, I'll take it. So I sort of made, it's just an IKEA, I can put the link in the description below as to what desk this actually is. I think they still sell them. They're basically just the stock standard IKEA range. But as you can see, like, they're supposed to have like a leg underneath here and a leg underneath there, but I took the legs out, so hopefully the structural integrity is okay. But I've just put one bench on top of the other one, and then on this end I just put a piece of wood in here that was the same height as the actual desk to keep it sturdy, which means that I have a cute little nook under here for, like, that's just rubbish, pieces of paper that I'm working on, or like my palettes and things. So that's really a cool storage in there. And then anyway, coming up here, I got my dad to make two just makeshift shelves. They were just pieces of plywood lying downstairs, or maybe it's timber, I'm not entirely sure. Pieces of timber lying downstairs, and he just decided to put three pieces of timber in between each, and they're just stacked on top of each other. So they're not particularly polished. I mean, they still have the pencil lines and kind of like marks all over them, but I really like that. It makes them really rustic, and it's sort of purely a practical purpose. Like, this whole setup itself isn't the most aesthetically pleasing. Like, I have different cups and different mugs and things to hold on my supplies, but I just really like the vibe it's gone. It's like created. It just kind of suits me down to the ground. And then up here I have, oh no, one's fallen down. There was one here. And then up here I have different pieces of art that I've done over the last couple of years. These three portraits keep reappearing. I like get sick of them and I put them underneath my bed, and then I get them back out again to like inspire me. So yeah, just different artworks I've done, different gifts I've been given, or different posters I've collected. I'm going to add a lot more to this space. And then over here we have, so I'll just go through my art supplies. This is just a bottle of kombucha that has water in it for when I do my watercolor painting, so it's just always there. And then I change it maybe once every couple of weeks. In these two, I have erasers and sharpeners, and also my charcoal supplies. So I won't go into that because it's kind of messy, but they live in those pencil cases. And then in these four tubs here, I have all my paints. So I have monochrome, I have reds and browns, yellows and golds, and then blues and greens and purples. So I like to keep them in color order. Now some of these, honestly, actually pretty much all of these paints I buy, see, you can see here, Dollar King at $3.99. Most of these, not bargain, $2.50. Most of these paints are just from secondhand shops or Asian $2 shops, you know, the ones they have sort of, yeah, the dollar buy, hot dollar kind of shops. I never ever buy paints full price. Now maybe that makes me a bad artist, I don't know. I suppose I'm not professional, so for me it doesn't make much of a difference. I'm quite content to paint with the basic sort of student acrylics. But some people like expensive ones, and that's totally fine too. And you can see here as well that, so at our hardware stores in Australia, they're called Bunnings Warehouse. They often have seconds, like paints that they've mixed up for someone, or just samples that have gone wrong, and they always have them sitting on a bench near the paint mixing area. And so I get them for like a brown for $2, a huge pot. This is a massive pot, and they're really great quality. Some of them are oils, most of them are water-based, and they're wall paints as well. So they operate really well on the canvas. You can splash them on really, really quickly. And they're just really practical. And so all of these paints, all of these pots of paints here have probably cost me a total of like $40. So If you'd like more tips on how to get paints and art supplies for cheap, let me know. There's lots of tricks and tips that I have developed over the years. Here I have a few more paints. This is actually car paint, so I'm keeping that for now. It didn't really, wasn't the same color as my car, even though I asked them to color match it, which was super annoying, so I just had that sitting there. And then in here I have my different paint brushes. So I've got smaller watercolor brushes in here, and then I have watercolor and acrylic brushes in this one, as well as some rulers and a paint mixer. And also a lot of palette knives are in amongst this. I am a huge fan of palette knives. Like, you don't even understand. I would prefer to use a palette knife over a paintbrush nearly any day of the week. And I actually did this painting with mostly palette knives. You have some brushwork sort of up in this area up here, but most of it's done with palette knives. And this was just like a really rough sort of, took me about an hour to do, so it's not very well polished, but anyway, that's sort of the vibe I like to go for, palette knives, and these were also all done in palette knives, so something that I like to play with every now and then. Then in these different containers here, I have my pens and pencils organized by category. Now, this was my boyfriend's idea. I'm not that organized when it comes to my art supplies, and I had a lot of like gel pens that were lying around that like didn't even work. So he went through them all, picked the ones that worked, sharpened all my pencils, put my pens and everything into categories. So from this end, we've got, oh, this is just like tape and decorative supplies, and I have my sticky tape and my stapler. Then I have practical pens. These are just like for everyday use, like a red pen, a blue pen, whatever. My everyday use pencils, so these are just for like sketching, that's supposed to be in there, for sketching and different things. I have some leads in there as well, and then these are my artistic pencils, so ones that come in like a set, so you've got all your different shades and strengths of pencils there. And then this one, there's just gel pens. This one is my practical supply, so scissors, whiteout, rulers, glue, that sort of thing. These are paint markers or whiteboard markers, just the larger sort of textures and things that you accumulate. These are felt tip colorful pens, and these are felt tip artist's pens. These pens in particular, the Uni Pen series, they are fantastic because they're not water based, they're water and fade proof. You can get them from Officeworks, and even wish.com.au have them for really cheap. They're my favorite kind of pens, and I actually need to get some more of these because I'm running out, and they tend to like sort of run out pretty quickly with the amount that I use them. So yeah, it's a very practical workspace, I think. It's pretty neat and tidy, and I like the way it's organized because it doesn't take a lot to reorganize it when all the pencils are in the right place. It's just very easy to use. Anyway, then I have two cupboards, one down here, one here. In this cupboard, I have a lot more art supplies. So I have my watercolors all sitting up here. This one, you know, I've got my palette watercolors and also my tube watercolors, watercolor pencils, watercolor traveling set. This is just some sewing stuff up here as well. And then more watercolors in the back. So I'm not gonna go through all of that because there's just so many art supplies. But most of these were either gifts or some of them I actually stole from high school, which is kind of rude, sorry. Sorry, high school. These are some blending markers I got for Christmas, which I'm very excited to use but haven't opened yet. This is my ridiculous. I don't know if you can see how many pencils are in there, but there is a lot. Like, that's probably 300 pencils or so in there. These are pencils that I've accumulated throughout my entire life. So starting from prep, basically, like when I was 5 years old at school, my mom would buy me pencils every single year because I'd beg for new pencils and I didn't need them. Like, I had the old pencils, they were perfectly fine, but I always wanted new pencils because all the other kids had new pencils. So I've got a lot. These are just mixed. Some of them are watercolors, some of them aren't. Just, yeah. And then in here I have some ink and charcoal supplies, and also just some more, like, I've got textures, I have got oil markers and pastel markers, things like that in there. So these are the ones that I don't use as often, but more like when I'm doing a specific commissioned piece or just wanting to experiment, I will use them. But I keep them at the bottom because I don't use them that much. So that's sort of this cupboard. And then moving across to this cupboard, I keep all of my paper supplies and then also miscellaneous items. So in this this drawer set in here, I have, so in the top one I keep my A5 and smaller journals, and I've got my A4, then I've got canvases, and then I've got photo frames in the bottom. These are all my A3, A2, I think they're just actually A3, sketch pads. And then underneath here I have more canvases in the corner, more sketch pads, ones that are used for different purposes. And then I have a lot of jars and palettes and things like that. That is pretty much it, guys. That's my entire desk and setup. And over the next couple of months, now that I actually have this office space set up and it's a new year and I really wanna be achieving new things with my time, My aim is to use this space every single day and to keep it tidy, but also to actually use the space. But yeah, so that's kind of my space, and I hope you enjoyed this tour, and I will see you in the next video where I hopefully will be painting something here or here.
Love you guys, and I wish you all the best 2020 and beyond, and we will be bringing you some fantastic, new and inspiring, uplifting and creative and fun content in the next couple weeks. So, see you on the flip side, friendlies.